God doesn't want you to be lost. It's not his desire for us to go through life, making all our money, partying the whole life through, and getting to the end of this thing, laying on a deathbed somewhere in some old nursing home or some old hospital, and we're taking our last breath, and all of a sudden then we decide, well, you know what? I never did give my life to God. I'm sorry. By that point in time, it's probably too late. Amen. I have seen a few deathbed repentances that God actually filled them with the Holy Ghost, and we actually got them baptized in Jesus' name before they died, but not very many, because you hear me, the Word of God is sure. Somebody will always have the opportunity to hear the truth. And the Bible said that the truth will set you free. Hallelujah. Amen. How many of you believe that?
Amen.
What's it set you free from? The laws of sin and death. You were bound up. Let me tell you something. The devil takes his little ring. Now, I used this example before, and it's kind of painful. Amen. I helped my father-in-law do this one time, and I didn't want to do that no more. It was kind of rough. But he had these hogs, these pigs. They weren't hogs yet. They were just pigs. And they kept rooting, trying to root under the fence of that pen they were in. So he took and I helped him. We got over in that pen, and I held a little pig between my knees, and that was a nasty thing. Amen. Held him by his ears, and he took this little ring. It had two sharp points on it. Woo! Can just imagine how that hurt. And they take these pair of pliers and they stick it up in that hog's nose and they squeeze it so that those little points dig into that hog's nose. Ow. Yeah. Now let me say something to you. You can take, I don't know how many of you deal with horses. I've dealt with a couple in my life, not many. Amen. We had a few over the years, and you can take that old horse and grab him by the lip. Horse is cutting up, you can grab him by the lip and squeeze it. Amen. Or any part of that nose, you can grab him by the nostril if you want to do that. It's kind of nasty. And just squeeze it. Amen. But he'll do what you want him to do. Because, I mean, that's their sensitive part. And with that old pig, we put that ring in his nose, and the points go dig up into his flesh. And he probably had a sore nose for a while, but you know what? He don't root no more. Because every time he tries to root, amen, those rings, them points stick into his flesh, so he don't do that anymore. Amen. So what happens is the devil does the same thing to us, basically. We think we make our own free will, okay? We think that we are our own free will person, so we choose to go to the club Saturday night. No. You got a devil that's got a little ring in your nose. He ties a little string to it, says, let's go to the club tonight. And so you just follow him right on in there. And you thought you figured that out. Yeah, I think I'll go to the club. No. The devil said, I don't think you'll go to the club Saturday night. So you're serving that master. The Bible calls him the master. You're serving that master. But guess what happens? The Holy Ghost comes in. God clips the ring, pulls it out, says, now you're on free will. Are you going to serve me of your own free will? Because I'm not going to put a ring in your nose and make you serve me like that taskmaster did. Amen? The Bible calls him a taskmaster. And I'm not going to make you serve me. You're going to serve me because you love me and you want to serve me. Hallelujah. You're going to serve me because I've filled you with the Holy Ghost, and now I've replaced all that sorrow, I've replaced all that trouble with a joy that is unspeakable and full of glory. And it doesn't really matter how life rolls around you. When you've got the Holy Ghost, you can lift up holy hands, the Bible said, without wrath and doubting. Hallelujah. In the temple of the Lord, you come to church and you worship God because he has said, you free.
Amen.
Amen. From the laws of sin and death.
Amen.
Amen. Satan's desire is to kill you.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Oh, hello. The Bible said he's come but for to steal, to kill, to destroy. I mean, that's all he's about. All these folks that serve Satan, he's Satanist. Amen. They worship Satan. I've been around that a lot. Over the years, dealt with it a lot, and people that worship Satan, guess what ends up happening to them? One day they wake up and the devil said, okay, it's your turn, big boy. I'm done with you. I've got all I want out of you now. And so he tells them to put a gun to their head and pull the trigger and let them do.
Yeah.
Amen. So you got to understand, you serve that, oh my, you serve that guy out there, and it's a law of sin and death. The destroyer is out to destroy you. He has no other plan. His plan is to take your life and mess it up as much as possible, and then finally end up killing you. Amen. And you'll end up paying the taskmaster. But the Lord, hallelujah, is not slack concerning his promise, not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. God's desire is for us to be saved from that lifestyle.
Yes.
Amen.
You know, the thing about it is, when you're in that lifestyle, a lot of folks have never been to church in their life, so they don't understand, amen, that lifestyle is really not something they just thought they would do. Hallelujah. Amen. They don't understand that, but the scripture bears out what I'm saying tonight. And you understand after you get in church, you look back and you go, my goodness, I cannot believe I was actually being led around by a spirit that was leading me and guiding me. Yeah. Amen. That's why we preach against some things we preach against. Why? Because there are spirits associated with them that will attack you, that will just try to destroy your walk with God. And so we will eventually destroy your walk with God. So we preach against that stuff. We give you a warning, a firm warning about it, because we want you to know. The Bible said we're not to be ignorant of the devil's devices. Hello. All right. That's another lesson. God doesn't want us to perish, but rather to repent. But then he reminds us, look at this, Luke 13:3. I tell you nay, but except you repent, you shall all likewise perish. So Jesus preached the doctrine of repentance. It wasn't just something we made up. He preached that. Repentance is not optional. There's no way you can go into church and just all of a sudden, bless God, you were one day in the world, the next day you're in church and you hadn't repented. You just kind of walked in the church and, you know, they kind of took you in and you were, you know, you're just a churchgoer.
Yeah.
And you're blessed God, you got a ticket to heaven. Sorry. That's not the word. Unless one lives a repentant life, he or she shall perish. What does the word perish mean here? Taken from the Greek word apolemi, the word perish, as used here, means to give over to eternal misery in hell. Wow. To perish, to be lost, to be ruined, to be destroyed, to destroy, to lose. Wow. Scripture backs that up. Matthew 16:26. For what is a man profited if he shall gain the whole world and lose his own soul? Or what shall a man give in exchange for his soul? Now, did you ever think about that? That while you're in the world doing the things of the world, you're actually giving an exchange for your soul? Oh, Lord.
Yeah.
You're actually cashing it in.
My Lord.
Yeah. You're making up your mind that you're going to live it your way, and you're not going to do it God's way. You're going to do it your way. And let me tell you something. There's too many soft soap and preachers in this day and hour. They'll pat you on the back and tell you, you're doing an awesome job. Bless God, you just keep on. And you're still living in sin. You're still shacked up with somebody. You're still going out to the bars. You're still drinking and having a high heel time. You're still doing drugs or whatever you do. Amen. You're still smoking. You're still cussing. You haven't changed one bit. And they'll pat you on the back. Let me explain something to you. Hell is going to be full of lying preachers.
Yeah.
Oh, Lord. And right along with them are all the people that they have deceived. I cannot deceive you. I have to tell you the truth. Sin is sin. God hates sin. He loves the sinner, but he hates sin. Amen. He wants us to separate ourselves from the sin of this world and to draw nigh to God. Oh, the Bible tells me if we draw nigh to God, he'll draw nigh to us.
That's right.
I want him close to me. Amen. With all the stuff going on in the world nowadays, you think I don't want God close to me? Something's wrong with me if I don't want him close. Amen. All right, so let's go on a little further. Remember, we've already determined repentance is a change of mind that involves a conscious turning away from wrong actions, attitudes, and thoughts in conflict with a godly lifestyle and biblical commands. Some think they can be saved by shaking a preacher's hand. can shake my hand till it falls off. And you won't be no more saved than you were before you started. You can go through town. Let me tell you, this is kind of humorous. Back years ago, I was preaching down in Wales, pastor down there, and I had a little preacher, a black preacher. He wanted me to come over and preach at his church, but I love to. I mean, I love to preach at black churches, so I went over there and visited. They had a fellowship meeting, so I went over to that fellowship meeting, kind of spy them out a little bit. And after the fellowship meeting, he had me testify, and so when I testified, Holy Ghost moved. He come up to me, his wife come up to me after church. She said, "Man, I can feel the Holy Ghost." She said she had the Holy Ghost. I don't know if the preacher did or not, but she did. And so we began to talk after church. And he told me, he said, "I've got this license from this organization. I got this license from this organization. This license from this organization." He had like 20 licenses from all these different organizations, different ministers. I'm like, "Man, you know what? That ain't going to do you one bit of good. Those things don't mean a hill of beans if you haven't got truth." Hallelujah. End result was I went back to his church the next week and I taught Jesus' name baptism, the infant of the Holy Ghost, and ended up baptizing the whole church in Jesus' name, including the pastor. Hallelujah. Amen. The Holy Ghost fell. You got to understand, God has a desire, and that is that we get away from our religious stuff. God hates religion. Lord, help me, Jesus. Boy, I'm really messing y'all up. God is not religious, okay? Never has been, never will be. You know where religion comes from? It's a man-made ideology. Hallelujah. Amen. We cannot make a man-made ideology up and live by that. We've got to go by the Word of God. Hallelujah. All right, so you can't shake a preacher's hand. You can't sign a church roll. You could sign every church roll in town and still go to hell.
That's right.
Hallelujah. Amen. That's obviously not what God thinks. His word is plain. Except you repent, you shall perish. Amen. You have to have a mind that thinks godly thoughts, not the trashy thoughts of this world. Amen. Couldn't think of a better word to put there. Trashy thoughts of God. Amen. What kind of thoughts do they think nowadays? I tell you what, when we were growing up, you know, I used to talk about how we got in trouble at school. Most of we got in trouble at school was for sticking gum under the desk or chewing gum in class or, you know, something like that. Now, amen, you get in trouble for bringing a gun to school and shooting somebody. So, you know, it's a different world. 1 Peter 1:13. Look at this. "Wherefore, gird up the loins of your mind." Philippians 2:5. "Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus." So repentance actually starts in the mind. Read what the word says. 2 Corinthians 10:5. "Casting down imaginations." You know, anybody ever had imagination? Yeah. Your imagination will get you in a heap of trouble, Rob. Don't let it run wild, okay? Hold on to that imagination. "And everything, or a high thing that exalteth itself against the knowledge of God, and bringing into captivity," look at this, "every thought to the obedience of Christ." You mean I've got to make my thoughts pure? If your thoughts ain't pure, guess what? Your life ain't going to be pure. If you got thoughts that are bad, amen, you're going to follow out what those thoughts are. Why? Because, this is not Bible. This is Benjamin Franklin. I've heard it quoted as Bible so many times. "The idle mind's the devil's workshop." Hello? You may have heard that?
Yeah.
That was not the Bible. That was Benjamin Franklin to come up with that one. But it's the truth. An idle mind is the devil's workshop. That's where he does his business at. Amen. You know, the Bible talks about the heart of a man. Guess what the heart of a man is? It's not the ticker in your chest. It's the ticker between your ears. Hallelujah. The heart of a man is your central nervous system, beginning with your brain running all through your body. Amen. It controls every function of your body. You hear me? Amen. And that's why when we give our heart, our mind to him, Amen. We let that same mind be in us that was in Christ Jesus. Hallelujah. Amen. We cast aside imaginations. We cast aside evil thoughts. And we just kind of keep our mind. The Bible tells me he will keep him in perfect peace whose mind is stayed on thee. Amen. He wants us to keep our mind on him. Yeah. All right. Philippians 4:8. Finally, brother, whatsoever things are true, whatsoever things are honest, whatsoever things are just, whatsoever things are pure, whatsoever things are lovely, whatsoever things are good report, if there be any virtue, if there be any praise, think on these things. Notice in the above scripture, we are admonished to cast down imaginations. But in the next scripture, Paul says we are to replace our wild imaginations with things that are true, honest, just, pure, lovely, and of a good report. So once I repented, is that it? You've got to change your mind, right? You're changing your mind. So repentance is not just a change of body. It's a change of mind. You turn this way and go back towards God and walk away from that sin that did so easily beset you. Amen. Now, some will tell you that grace covers everything. So they continue in their immoral lifestyle, professing themselves to be saved. Who do they think they are fooling? You ain't fooling God. You ain't fooling God. Paul says it this way, Romans 6. What shall we say then? Shall we continue in sin that grace may abound? Hello. Those guys that preach grace covers it all. I'm sorry. Paul said you can't do that. We can't continue in sin that grace can just be there for us. Hallelujah. We're just going to church and we're covered by grace. So now I can profess I'm a Christian. I can sing in the choir on Sunday night. And yet on Monday I'm out, or Saturday night before church on Sunday, I'm in the bar room. It don't happen that way. There's got to be a separation. It starts in the mind. Hallelujah. A made up mind says, you know what? I'm through with it. I'm walking away from it. I'm walking to you, God. You're it. Amen. Hallelujah. All right. I'm trying to get through. I really am. God forbid. How shall we then that are dead sin live any longer therein? Paul goes on to say this in verse 6, same chapter. Knowing this, that our old man is crucified with him, that the body of sin might be destroyed, that henceforth we should not serve sin. For he that is dead is free from sin. Then he adds it, and he's not talking about physical death, he's talking about spiritual death. You have died out to the old man. Then he adds that we are to let not sin therefore reign in our mortal bodies, that we should obey the lust thereof. So we can't allow sin to live here. You know why? The bodies, you know what the Bible said about your body? What? Know ye not that your body is
the temple
of the Holy Ghost, whose you are? And you have been bought with a price. You're not your own. Amen. You don't belong to you no more. When you give yourself to God, you belong to him. He fills you with his spirit. This body no longer is mine. It's his. Hallelujah. I have to submit this body to him. I have to just say, God, my body wants to do some crazy things, but I refuse to do them because I'm not there no more. I'm here with you. Hallelujah. I need you to come and help me. You are my strength. You are my soul. You're everything to me. Amen. Amen. All right. Someone will be leading you. You will obey one or the other. Remember I talked about the pig just a minute ago with the ring in his nose. You can tie a string in that ring and lead him anywhere. He'll follow you. I promise. Matthew 6:24. No man can serve two masters. For either he will hate the one and love the other, or else he will hold to the one and despise the other. Know ye not that to whom you yield yourselves servants, to obey his servants ye are, of whom ye obey, whether of sin unto death or obedience unto righteousness. Paul says we were servants of sin until we obeyed from the heart. Notice he says that the doctrine that was delivered to you, the doctrine of repentance and baptism, the same one we talked about earlier, that the apostle was instructed to teach, Romans 24:47, but God be thanked that ye were the servants of sin, but ye have obeyed from the heart that form of doctrine which was delivered to you. He said, you've had a heart change. You've had a heart transplant. Hallelujah, spiritual heart transplant. you have followed that form of doctrine which was given to you. Being then made free from sin, you became the servants of righteousness. I speak after the manner of men because of the infirmity of your flesh. For as you have yielded your members servants to uncleanness and to iniquity and to iniquity, even so now yield your members servants to righteousness unto holiness.